I could carry on with the Fleetwood Mac stuff for the rest of the evening. I say this every week. Terrible. It's becoming a catchphrase. Hi, guys. How you doing? Nick Jennison with Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. It's Monday. We're doing the thing which we do on Mondays, which is forget to trim our beards and hang out and talk about the guitar. If you are joining us for the first time, hey, it's great to have you on board. Thank you so much for taking the time out of your evening, especially now that the evenings are a little lighter in the UK. That caught me like a ton of bricks on Sunday morning. Monday morning, rather. Whatever morning it is, Sunday morning when I woke up, let me tell you, getting in late from a gig and then waking up to find I'd lost an hour in bed. Ugh, death. But yeah, if you're taking some time out of your evening to join us, hey, listen, thank you so much for coming on board. If you're one of our returning streamers, one of our growing community of Monday evening guitar players, we need a good name for it, although I feel like Cowcat has coined a great name for our little group of streamers, which is Bad Monkeys. Very on point. I like that a lot. I feel like the monkeys thing has been somewhat done by another bearded British guitar YouTuber of note. But even still, hey, listen. And of course, if you're catching this in the replay, hey, listen, it's great to have you on board. Today, we're talking about bending and vibrato. We're picking up where we left off last week, because last week we had a big discussion on the mechanics of bending and vibrato. Today, we're going a little deeper into the musical aspects of bending and vibrato, these most important techniques that separate us from bass animals, so to speak. It's very poetic today. Maybe I'll stop with that. So anyway, listen, a couple of things before we get going. First of all, once again, thank you so much for joining us. If you're enjoying what we're doing here, a couple of ways you can help us keep the lights on. You can go to this URL right here. See that down there, down below here? It may be obscured by your play bar, but it is right there. It says get more lessons. Go to guitarinteractivemagazine.com/GI+, where you can go and get more lessons from the likes of myself, first of all, but also Tom Quayle, Andy James, Andy Wood, Rick Graham, Sam Bell, Giorgio Cerchi, Michael Caswell, Don Alder, another very, very good one, Lewis Turner, very underrated as GI Plus contributors go, just recently discussed having a new acoustic series of lessons made with a very good friend of mine who we'll talk about in a minute. We got some stuff coming from Sam, we got some stuff coming from a bunch of other contributors, and I have some new stuff in the can for you. I'm just moving this microphone because I'm very aware that it is just buried within me. That's better. So anyway, listen, you can do that. You can also give the stream a thumbs up on whatever platform you're watching on. You can also share this with your guitar playing friends. We'd like to get this out to as many guitar players as humanly possible, so consider sharing this around to people you think might get some good use out of it. Now listen, if a friend has directed you to this stream, just want to let you know, they don't think that you have bad vibrato or that you're bad at bending. That's not why they've sent you here, so please do not be offended if your friend sends you a stream that says bending and vibrato, what do? So listen, let's check in with our community streamers and then we'll get stuck in with the lesson today. So first of all, PJ, the king is dead. Marcin has been beaten through the door. PJ is first. You've won. The battle is over. We won. Dude, great to see you. And Marcin was good enough to congratulate him 1 minute. 1 minute after the fact. Absolutely tremendous. Love that. Now, I will say, I think that's because the stream was a little late going live today. Didn't go live until between 5 and 6 p.m. But yeah, like first through the door, PJ, rock on. Very, very cool. So anyway, listen, who else do we have? Rory Lisman's in the house. Rory Lisman is one of my favorite contributors. Always has great, great, great insights into the stuff we're doing. Love to see it. So it's great to have you on board. Sacred Godslayer, our resident metal expert and Italian translator. Also in the house, good to have you. Foghorn is just here. Congrats on PJ for being first through the door. Love it. David Yates is in. 7 p.m. and the sun is yet to set. Happy days. You know what? Like, so good. I immediately feel more like a person now that the UK is on daylight savings time. I don't know why we don't do this all year round, but who knows? I'm sure there are reasons. I think the Gregorians are involved. Whatever that means. Damn lot that did the calendar. Who else do we have? Lots of discussion about Marcin's timekeeping devices, digital like his rig. That makes a lot of sense. Mark Crandall is in the house, says, hey Nick, everyone, hope you're all doing well. Doing great, man. Being irritated by my own facial hair. It needs to go, but I did not find the time today. The 8 p.m. crept up on me way too quick. But never mind. Cowcat is in the house, coining the term bad monkeys to describe a noun of guitar players, or a collective noun of guitar players. Here's a point of discussion for you, by the way. Collective nouns, like a murder of crows and like a herd of cattle or whatever. What do you think is a good collective noun for guitar players? We have currently come up with, the best we can think of is a whittle of guitar players, which I think is quite good. We also have a pretension of vocalists, but that's another story. So yeah, collective nouns for guitar players in the comments, go. Who else do we have? Kim is in the house. Kim, it's great to see you. We're going to see Kim, or I'm going to see Kim next weekend. And then the beginning of the following week, we're down shooting some lessons. We're doing a very experimental, cool new project called Guitar Boot Camps, where we're doing some one-to-one, not so much one-to-one, but small group tuition. It's internet-based. You know, we'll post links down below, so if you guys want to get on the Guitar Bootcamp train, it's not too late. We're discussing guitar tone, which is very interesting. It's the Guitar Tone Secrets Masterclass. So, yeah, we'll be seeing Kim. That's Sunday, April the 2nd, by the way. I should point that out now. Sunday, April the 2nd, that is this coming Sunday. So if you're interested in that, links will be down below. Keith MOF is in the house. Keith, it's great to see you. Timothy Appling is tuning in from Florida Keys. I guess I'm not so early. Last couple of weeks' lessons were 4 p.m. UK USA time. So today it's 3 p.m. for the lesson. I'm glad I checked. Otherwise, we'd be an hour late at the sunny beach. Yeah, I'm glad you checked too, man. It's good to have you on board. Daylight savings times. This is another thing. Why can't we all agree to switch at the same time? There's this period of a couple of weeks where the US and the UK just go completely out of sync with each other. And it's like trying to arrange anything across continental is absolutely bonkers. And then we all come back into sync, which is cool. I gather out, correct me if I'm wrong here, I think Arizona doesn't do daylight saving time either, which is kind of crazy, because I think, you know, the last thing they need is more daylight. Who else do we have? Liam Tate is in the house. Yeah, for 2 weeks, what I've just said, there you go, right? Yeah, US and UK are out of sync. Absolutely bonkers. Steve McDee is in the house, a regular on our stream. Steve, it's great to have you on board. Hi, Nick. Hi, everyone. My bending and vibrato was actually improved during the last week. Yes, that's what we like. Ready for more input. I am super glad to hear that, because as I'm sure you guys will agree, bending and vibrato, it's the thing that separates us from many other instruments, specifically better designed, but I'm going to say less cool instruments. I would say that I'm a guitar player. I've talked before about how the guitar is the worst designed instrument in the world, in that you have to press bits of metal that hurt to make notes come out, and then you have to reserve your good hand to hit the thing with plastic, and it's like there are six overlapping monophonic strings that are tuned in fourths, which is bizarre, apart from this one, G and B, which is tuned in a third because of the Spanish. But that also means we get to do this, as opposed to something like a piano, which is an incredibly well-designed instrument, but piano players can't do this. Which puts us more in the realm of the human voice, but the human voice can't do this. Etc. Right, and you have to make the face when you're doing those chords. So yeah, you know, pros and cons to each, but it's one of the things that makes the guitar just so, our ability to bend and do vibrato and do chords. Mark McNish is in the house. Mark, it's great to see you. Our friend Kendo Nakasaki. what a name, right? Wrestling fans will know what I'm talking about here. Says, good evening, it's great to have you, man. I know you missed it last week, so listen, it's good to have you on board. Falconish, you've been watching Amazon Prime, haven't you, Nick? Shush, yes, I have. Nina and I have been binging Daisy Jones and the Six, and the music is tremendous. I'll just say that right. And we also, yeah, I also had this Fleetwood Mac backing track in the annals, let's say, and I realized I hadn't played over it in ages, so I thought we'd bust it out. Our friend Miguel is in the house. My friend Ant, Gatecrasher Ant, is in the house with a wonderful profile picture. He says, foie and spongle. There you go. That's Ant. Expect sausage-related commentary as the evening goes on. Anyway, who else do we have? A gas of guitar players. Oh, we're getting into the collective nouns. I like that. A gas of guitarists. That's very good. A noise of guitar players. That's pretty good. A trauma of guitar players. Wow. I mean, it depends if you're listening. A fretboard of guitar players. I'm into that. What else do we have? No amplification, Nick. What's going on? Never mind. That was some incredible tone there, Nick. Acoustically resonant. Eh? Oh, I know what's going on. Is that the Forgot to turn the stream on. So I have, that's what we're trying to play. Never mind. Pretend that the amp is on for those examples. Yeah, I have it on a button so I can fade the backing track out, and it also fades the guitar out so it doesn't just, like, cut off. But anyway, there you go. And I forgot to switch it back on because, hey, human beings, what are you going to do? Mark Crandall says, a gaggle of hacks for player on my levels. I think you're underestimating your level there, my man, but it's also a hilarious term. We love that. So listen, anyway, let's get stuck into the meat of today's session. That's better, says Philip Hawthorne. Thanks, man. Although, to be fair, be impressed at how loud this guitar is acoustically, because that's a pretty loud guitar, right? It never used to be this way. I have this theory that guitars get better the more you play them, especially if you play them with intent. If you play them with love and you play them with anger and all that sort of thing. So this guitar has had a lot of love and a lot of anger poured into it over the years, and it's turned from something pretty good into something absolutely magical. It's my favorite, still my number one, although I only really use it for solos these days because it has this beautiful soloing voice. I have other guitars that I reach for to do other things with. So anyway, listen, let's get into it. Now, last week, I'm going to turn the delay off because that was getting a little bit annoying. Last week, we discussed the mechanics of bending and vibrato, specifically the mechanics of intonation with bending and vibrato. Oh, here's a good question, by the way. The Steve Vai vibrato. Hello, GIM, Guitar Interactive Magazine. What do you think about Steve Vai's vibrato? Isn't that a little bit theatre? That's an interesting comment. Eric, we are going to flag that up, and we're going to answer that in our Q&A session a little bit later on. It's a very good question. So if you've got questions, don't forget, by the way, you got any burning questions, drop them down below. Right, drop them right here in the comments, and we'll be answering them at the top of the hour. So anyway, listen, let's crack on. So we discussed our bending and vibrato mechanics. Let's just grab another one of the same kind. That's better. There we go. We're going to go to the close-up cam for this real quick. I'm just going to show you what we're talking about. So we were discussing, let me just rearrange that. Wow, that is very out of shot. That's much better. So anyway, we're discussing this idea that your bending and your vibrato can come from a bunch of different places, but we're trying to set it up in such a way that the mechanisms we use to fret, i.e. the muscles of the hand and the fingers, are kind of left alone for a couple of reasons. First of all, what we don't want is we don't want to be bending and then running out of steam to play other lines, right? So if we're pushing with our fingers like this, maybe not the greatest idea, because tension kind of builds up in the fingers. It's very hard to release that quick enough to get into interesting stuff. But much more importantly, we use the muscles of the fingers and the hand in our bends to micro intonate the bends. So what we do is this is how we actually bend and tune. We listen and we respond to what it is that we're playing. So we bend up, and then we allow our fingers to massage the note into pitch. And the more we do this, the faster we get at it, and the better we become at, let's call it perceived bending accuracy, the ability to bend into tune and have it sound like it's in tune, for want of a better term. So, for example, if I try and keep my fingers super rock solid and rigid, it's a little difficult for me to massage that bend into tune. However, with a loose finger and a bend coming from the large muscles of the arm and the forearm, my fingers are then free to apply a little bit of extra pressure or release a little bit of pressure to get my bend to be in tune. And this is very similar to the way that violinists intonate. We talked about this at length in last week's stream, so if you missed that, you can go on the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel. Make sure you give us a subscribe while you're there. You can go and check that stuff out. So that's some of the technical aspects. We also discussed the same thing with vibrato. Today, we're going to get more into the musical aspects of this. So we've discussed this in previous streams when we talked about how some of your favorite artists do their vibrato. We're not going to get into that too much today. We're going to talk more about your personal vibratoing approach. And something I've talked about in the past that I want to touch on again is the idea of the perceived amount of vibrato that we can put on any given note. Now, if you imagine that there are several qualities that we can apply to a vibrato, we might start with width and speed, which are the traditional ones we talk about. If we apply lots of both, we tend to think of a note as having a lot of vibrato. Think about Zakk Wylde when we talk about this stuff. So lots of speed, lots of wide, we get this sort of thing. So it's fast, it's wide, it sounds like there's a lot of vibrato going on. If, by contrast, we apply a very slow and very shallow vibrato, we sound like there's not so much happening. It sounds like there's a very little vibrato going on, like this. Now, we can strike a balance somewhere in between these amounts of vibrato, by either using, let's say, a medium amount of each, which might be something like this. So medium speed, medium depth, or we can have a lot of one and not much of the other. So if we have a shallow, fast vibrato, Peter Green quiver, that works really well. Or we can have a slow and comparatively wide vibrato, which is the John Sykes vibrato. Which gives us options on how we apply this stuff. Now, the only real I guess we can talk about what's appropriate for different musical settings, that's fine, but the only real arbiter of, you know, whether you should apply a lot of vibrato, not a whole lot of vibrato, or somewhere in between, is the immortal question that we ask on these streams all the time, which is, do you like it? So if you like the sound of a lot of vibrato, you like it to be fast and wide, or you like the sound of just a tiny bit of vibrato, just the subtlest, slowest of wobbles, or anywhere in between, then it's all good. You get to make these decisions as the musician. Herbie Hancock talked about this in a reel I saw recently. He wasn't talking about it in a reel, but it was a reel of him talking about it, where somebody asked about, you know, is jazz in particular, is it for the listener, or is it for the player? You know, like, basically trying to justify self-indulgence, I guess. And Herbie came up with a phenomenal answer where he says, music is always for the listener, but the player is the first listener. Like, oh, yes. So what we're getting at here is we're trying to find a way that we can do vibrato that you like the sound of. Now, we're going to come back to the 10-note lesson a little bit later on, for you guys who remember that. That's something I stole from Nick Harrison, a friend of mine. I steal lots of stuff from Nick. I steal lots of stuff from lots of folks. And I think that's okay. It's part of the musical tradition that we're dealing with here. We're going to come back to that in a minute. But before we do, let's just go back to our Fleetwood Mac style backing track. It's in the key of A minor. And we're going to jam for a minute. And we're going to see if we can influence the amount of vibrato on a given note. The note is going to be E, and we're going to play it here on fret number 9 on our G string. You can approach this any way you want. You can slide in, you can bend in, but what we're looking for is to play with the amount of vibrato that we have on this note. Now, I'm going to do a little bit first, and I'm going to start with the least perceptible amount of vibrato I can make. Grab your guitars, because we're going to do this together. So if I go, let's increase the speed. So if I go like this, that's my barely perceptible vibrato. Let's keep that width the same, and this time crank up the speed. So it's very vocal, Now, here comes an interesting test. I'm going to see if I can keep the same amount of vibrato amount going between a slow but slightly wider vib and then a shallow and fast vibrato. And you guys can decide and let me know in the comments which one you prefer. There's room for both, right? But here we go. Here is shallow and fast. Here's slow and wide. It's not super wide, but it's a little wider. Can you hear how they both have the same amount of perceived vibrato on them, but a different vibe? Let's go again. So it feels like there's just a little bit there. Widen out to keep the same amount of perceived wobble, but they have different sounds going on. Does that make sense? Let me know in the comments which one you preferred. Did you prefer the slow and wider vibrato or the fast and shallow one? Right? Let me know in the comments. In the meantime, though, let's crack on. Both work well, says Eric. Yeah, for sure. Barracuda00007 says, I like the slow one for this track, I think. It's interesting. I kind of do too, but for me, this is a track that sits in the cusp of that 80s, 70s thing. For me, when I go for the slower vibrato, it sounds like I'm leaning into the John Sykes thing, and it's a bit more 80s sounding, whereas I feel like there's a cool 70s vibe from the slower, the shallower, faster one. But hey, you know, there's room for each. Ultimately, the point with this is not to establish that one is better than the other. The point is to establish which one you like better, so you can do more of it. Okay, cool. Let's do a medium one then. Let's do a medium width, medium speed. I'm going to go back to the close-up camera show. And you can do this with me, right? So if I go medium width, medium speed. Let's go fairly shallow, quite fast. Let's let the Angus Young vibrato. Let's go slow and wide. John Sykes vibrato, not quite. So once again, slow and wide. Medium at both. Fast and shallow-ish. All three sound pretty cool, but ultimately this is cool. This is the interesting thing. Because we're manipulating these two variables and we're playing them off against each other, as we increase our speed, we decrease our depth, we're getting the same amount of drama in the note. We can be subtle, but we can still play with whether we want the vibrato to be fast or slow, whether we want it to be wide or shallow, and we can manage that in a whole bunch of interesting different ways, right? Sacred Godslayer's got a really fun one where he says one can start shallow and finish wide. Now, that's really cool. That would be an example of something that's a little like the singing technique, which I always get wrong. It's mezza di voce, which I always mix it with mezzo voce, which is the half voice. Apologies for butchering these Italian pronunciations, by the way. Northeastern accents, we struggle with Italian names. I struggle with Italian pronunciations. Norwegian stuff we can do very well, but Italian stuff not so much. But yeah, what we can do here is we can do this thing where we intensify the note as we go on by either increasing the speed or the depth of our vibrato. Let's take a listen, right? So let's go to that. Intensifying our vibrato as the note goes on. So if I start here, I'll intensify that with depth as we go on. Pretty cool. Let's keep the depth the same and intensify the speed. Also cool, but has a very different vibe. This one sounds like it's becoming more aggressive as we go on. This one sounds like it's becoming more sensitive, more mournful as it goes on. Very interesting. We can also do the opposite, where we de-intensify the note as it goes on. So we can start like this. That takes a little more control. So let's try that together. Let's start very wide and then gradually shrink the vibrato as we go on. Messed that up. Let's try it again. Very hard not to get tense while you're doing this and cause it to be faster. Let's do it where we start fast and then we slow down as we go. That's a very cool sound. Right, let's try that again. Let's see what John Sykes do, which is very, very cool. Now, this idea of amount of vibrato, man, like, yeah, that's huge, right? That's a big deal. Here's an interesting one. Great question from Twitch has come in. What's the easiest song to learn? Easiest song to learn for vibrato, right? The easiest song to learn is probably, there's a bunch of them, right? Smoke in the Water is pretty easy. Easiest song to learn for vibrato is the solo from The Chain while we're talking about Fleetwood Mac, because it's this. And then up here. That makes sense. So yeah, easiest one to learn for vibrato. What's the hardest? Ooh, yikes. I am going to suggest, hardest one I can think of off the top of my head right now is to learn the entirety of 6 Degrees of Inner Turbulence by Dream Theater, because it's 45 minutes long and everything in it is quite hard. But imagine sinking the amount of time to learn a 45-minute continuous piece of music. Very good questions, though, man. Very good questions. Always wanted to learn the guitar but never had the opportunity. You should do it. There's never been a better time to learn the guitar. Thanks for your questions. Appreciate that. It's nice that somebody's watching us on Twitch. Nobody watches us on Twitch. We're always on YouTube. Nobody's watching us on Twitch, but that is good to see. So yeah, thanks for your questions, man. I appreciate it. So anyway, listen, right, that's our vibrato. Can we do something similar with bends, right? With our bends, is there something we can do where we can regulate the intensity of our bends? Because we've established that we can use all sorts of different vibrato techniques and all sorts of different musical vibrato approaches to regulate the intensity and the perceived amount of our vibrato. What about bends? Well, a couple of ways we can do it. We can control how far we bend, but that's kind of a given, right? So I'll show you a few examples of that. Let's take the idea of getting up to this note right here again. We're in A minor. Right, we can do that. Let's talk about the ways we could bend up to this. So we could begin by doing the standard 2-fret bend. That works pretty well. We can also bend up by a semitone, which is a different effect. We can bend up by 2 tones. That has a very interesting dramatic effect. We could also slide and bend to get the biggest. Biggest bend in all of human bending ever. Those are ways that we can manage how far we bend, but I don't think that's the most interesting thing to talk about when it comes to bending and managing your intensity. Instead, let's talk about how we get there. So let's talk about how quick and the curve we take from doing the bend. We've got some great questions coming in. I'm going to answer these, right? Because I love that you're asking these questions. Doesn't your fingers hurt from this? It definitely does when you start, but like anything else, you get better at it. So, they don't hurt anymore. I've developed a layer of very tough skin on my fingertips, and they don't hurt. And in addition to playing guitar, I also pick up and put down heavy things as a hobby. So, 600-pound deadlifts, they hurt your hands more than the guitar does. But it's a very good question, because if you've never played the guitar before, you might look at it and go, wow, doesn't that hurt? It kind of does the first few times, but the pain goes away. It's not really a bad pain. You should definitely think about picking it up. It's a really rewarding instrument. It's great fun. So anyway, listen, let's carry on. I probably wouldn't do that. No, probably wouldn't do that. I'd probably just let your fingers suffer for a while, and then they'll get tough and they'll get strong, and then you'll be good. So anyway, listen, right, let's crack on. So bends, right, because I could answer these questions as we go, right, and I will. Any more questions, I'll just bump to the Q&A. We're doing a Q&A session at the end of this stream, which is going to be in about half an hour's time, so we'll do any more questions then. Like this one from Steve Ford that's just come in. Steve, I will answer your question, but I'll do it at the top because I don't want to miss anything. I don't want to derail the thing that's going on here. Okay, very important question. What's the price of this guitar? This guitar is very expensive. That's all I'm going to say. But you can get very good guitars for not a lot of money. Anyway, listen, let's talk about bending, how we get there. Let's talk about what I call the arc of bending, right? How fast we get from position one to position two. Let's do this together, right? What we're gonna do here, we're gonna go back to our Fleetwood Mac backing track. We're gonna play this D note and bend it up to the pitch of this A note, or this E note, two note, two frets, right? That's what we're looking for. Let's start by getting there as quick as we can, like this. So let's go. Does that make sense? Let's try it again. As quick as we can get there. That has a particular sound to it. Let's do it again, but this time, let's get there as slowly as we can. So let's go like this. That's an interesting sound too, maybe a little too slow. So let's go somewhere in between. Then, let's do it where we start slow and then start to speed up as we get closer to the note, like this. That's a very cool sound. Let's do that again. So we start slow, and then we ease into the pitch a little faster as we go. So it's almost like it goes like, oh, this direction. It goes like this, but smooth. That's a very, very common, very like human sound to make. So let's try again, right? One more time. We're gonna start slow and then. So a bend has a curve to it, right? Let's go really fast again. That's got a sound. That has a sound. That also has a sound. Now, if you wrote these down, they would just say bend, toe, right? Fine, but there's much more to it than that. Let's go a bit further with this. Let's get a little deeper into the weeds, right? So we have our bend and our arc. Let's do the opposite. So let's start fast and then slow as we edge our way into the pitch, like this. That has a sound. Let the backing track reset. Very interesting. Very interesting. Now, that's our bending arc. But here's another thing. We haven't talked about the right hand yet. We haven't talked about the right hand at all. Now, we have discussed right hand tone production before, but here's an interesting thing, right? Here's an interesting thing for you guys. The right hand and how we touch the string with our right hand has a more profound effect on our bends and our vibrato than it does on any other note, I think, right? This is my pet theory, right? But bears out, okay? Let me show you what I mean. So I'm going to do some flat, fairly gentle picking that should produce a very round tone like this. Let's do some very curved picking that's quite aggressive with quite a pronounced harmonic. Now, that produces a very different sound. I'll go between the two. When we start to apply this on bends, it becomes huge because the act of bending and bowing the string against our fret, which is kind of what we're doing, modulates that sound that we've produced in a really interesting way. So let's start with a flat and round sound. Let's start with a very aggressive harmonic-y sound. So there we've got this screaming type bend. Let's turn it into a weeping type bend. Screaming, weeping. Didn't change the vibrato, didn't change the bend. All I changed was the right hand touch. This is fascinating because the right hand touch becomes then part of a system that goes together into the way we want a bend to sound. So we're not just thinking about things like Let me think now. We're not just thinking about things like, you know, how fast do we want to get there? We're not just thinking about things like, do we get there in tune? We've dealt with that with the mechanics. We're now thinking about what sort of effect do we want the bend to have on the listener? Do we want it to sound like a wail or a scream or a snarl or a laugh or crying or whatever, you know, the emotive dramatic effect that we want? Here's a very fun thing. Once you experiment with this for a while, you kind of stop thinking about the nuts and bolts, right? The more you do it, the more it just starts to kind of happen. And you start to reach for these sounds in your playing, and they just appear. So let's do it, right? Let's do a few together. Let's see if we can construct bends that have some different emotive characters to them. Let's maybe start with the same bend again, but this time, let's do maybe something with a gentle touch. I'll maybe go to the neck pickup, and I'll play with a slow sweep in to create a mournful, weeping kind of sound. This time, let's be aggressive with our bend. But a very assertive kind of sound. And let's marry that with a hard pick attack with quite a long picture. Let's do that same thing, but this time let's stick with the chirp, but let's make it more sweeping, where we start with a slow approach and then quickly get into the note as we get going. We'll apply the slow vibrato and we're going to sound dramatic like Malmsteen. Let's do it with the slowest of vibratos on neck pickup and quite an aggressive attack. And let's see if we can get that big, super dramatic John Sykes tone like this. Comment here, because Brain Dog has a very, very good observation. The release of the bend makes quite a difference. Sure does. Let's talk about that. So a couple of ways we can release a bend. Here's a few things. We can release it quickly. We can release it slowly. We can not release it at all, right? By not release it all, I mean we bend up and we mute, which would be something like this. Then we can release that bend. Now, here's the thing. I think once you start doing vibrato, you probably shouldn't release unless you're going for a very specific effect. So the vibrato, I wouldn't apply until you've settled on the final pitch. The bend is over. But let's do some slow release. Let's do some fast release. Very different. Very different. That feels really affirmative. This feels very languid and dramatic, almost like the guitar is weeping. It's a great sound. If we don't release at all, it can still sound very cool. It sounds like that pitch we were going up to was the intended pitch all along. Here's another fun thing we can do. We can do the Brian May thing of bending up, pre-bending, and then releasing. So we can go Pre-band, great fun. That's another story for another day, I guess. But that's another thing, yeah, the release of the band does make an absolutely humongous difference. Guys, we've got a load of questions coming in, right? So I want to make sure we make time for them. So what I want to do, I want to take a quick minute and show you this in case you missed it. This is an example of some of the stuff that you get as part of your GI Plus membership. This is the course Expressive Techniques Part 1, where we discuss how to cultivate this in your playing in a whole bunch of different ways, right? A whole bunch of different ways. But what I want you to do in the meantime, while we're watching this, you've got three minutes to do this in. You're going to do the following, right? You're going to watch what's going on in the stream, but I also want you to have a little think about how good you are at playing notes that you like the sound of. When we come back, we're going to assess, and then we'll do some Q&A. I'll tell you all about that in a minute, but I'm going to give you a powerful lesson you can use to establish that stuff. But first, Expressive Techniques Part 1. This is what you get. It's a huge course, very in-depth. It's available as part of your GI Plus membership. Check it out. Hi guys, Nick Jennison with Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. Does your playing sound like this? When really you'd like it to sound like this. Now, the difference between these two examples are not the notes that are being played, but rather the way the notes are being played. I'm sure you've heard this before. Guitar players will say to you, it's not what you play, it's how you play it. And when it comes to creating interesting, emotive, and musical sounding guitar lines, that is very much the case. And in this course, Expressive Techniques Part 1, we aim to equip you with the tools to sound more musical, more emotive, more interesting, and ultimately more expressive on the guitar. And we are going to do this by exploring the three principal left-hand expressive techniques, which are slides, bends, and vibrato. I'm going to show you the mechanics of these techniques and how you can execute them cleanly, efficiently, and reliably. I'll also give you some exercises to help develop these techniques. And we're also going to discuss some musical applications, how you might use these techniques in your own playing. We're going to go into great depth with that stuff. And I'm also going to give you a solo study, a piece of music I've prepared. And I'm going to encourage you and kind of guide you through the process of applying expression to an otherwise expressionless and bare sounding piece of guitar playing. So at the end of this course, you are going to be able to take otherwise uninteresting and fairly dry pieces of music and turn them into expressive, colorful, musical lines. And you're also going to be able to take this and apply it to your own playing or to other people's music that maybe you're playing and you want to express in your own way. This is Expressive Techniques Part 1. My name is Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. I hope you'll join me. I will see you in there. So there we go. That is Expressive Techniques Part 1. I thought I could stifle a cough as we were going through a cable and coughing. Oh, no. But I could not. Right, I was caught red-handed. Anyway, that's Expressive Techniques Part 1. If you want more information on this stuff, you really want to develop these elements in your playing along with your bending, sliding, all that sort of stuff, that's the place to go do it, right? It's a great course. Really, really, really proud of it. Now, here is a thing for you guys. A lesson, a very powerful lesson that I did not come up with, let's say. yeah, a very powerful lesson that I didn't come up with, but nonetheless a very powerful lesson used for all sorts of stuff. This is the 10-note lesson. The 10-note lesson is where you play 10 notes and only 10 notes, and you use that to get a percentile score of how good you are at playing stuff you like. I'm going to encourage you to do this once this stream is over. So keep your guitars on you, do the 10-note lesson, and then, you know, you can come back to this video, drop us a comment, and let us know what your score was. I'm going to give you an example. So I'm going to go back to the close-up cam, and I'm going to play this, right? It's not backing track once again. I'm going to play 10 notes with bends and vibrato, and I'm going to assess how much I like each one of them. A score out of 10, and I'll make a little note. I'm going to open up a notes thing here. Let's make a new note. Let's see how we get on, right? So if I go, kind of like that. I feel like the vibrato could have been a little better, but you know, it's maybe, maybe say an 8. Pretty good. If I played that, it's the only thing you heard me play, I'd be pretty chuffed. Let's do another. I'm going to give that maybe a 9. Yeah, pretty good. Okay, let's go like this. Didn't quite sustain the way I wanted it to, so it was pretty good to begin with, and then it tailed off. I'm going to give it a 7. Let's do one more. Oh, baby. That was great. That was a really good note. That's getting a 10, right? Could not have asked for a better note. If I was making an album, that would go on the take. Let's do another. Ooh, that was pretty bad. That was flat. So I'm going to give that a 3. Tone was pretty good, but it was kind of flat. How many have we done? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Kind of did that on purpose to show you how it works, but even still. That was cool. I like that a lot. That's going to be a 9. Let's do one more. Oh yeah, that was good. That's going on the album, right? That's 10. Hooray! Now, I've done a few notes there, right? I didn't do all 10, but I gave each one a score based on one thing and one thing alone, which is, did I like the way that sounded, right? I did a little bit of self-reflection on each, and I thought to myself, why did I like this? Why didn't I like it? What am I looking for about this that I like? What is it about notes that I'm into that I want to listen for, and what am I doing to make those notes happen? How do I make that sound happen? Now, what I'm doing here, once I've done that, is I'm going to take all 10 scores that I've given, I'm going to add them up, and that gives me a score out of 100, which is a percentage score. My goal over time is to increase the percentage score of how much I like the notes I'm playing, and this is just a test. Right, it's a little test to see how good you are. I am going to get you guys, once this stream is over, to do the 10-note lesson for your bends and vibrato. You can do it for all sorts of stuff. You can do it for note choices, if you like. You can imagine a note and play it, see how accurate you are at it. But I like it for tone production. It's a very cool tool for that. There you go, the 10-note lesson. Didn't make it up. I stole it, right? Sorry, Nick. Nick doesn't mind. I'll always give him credit for this sort of stuff. So anyway, listen, it's time for the Q&A. Huzzah, your question's answered. Look at that, it's appeared. The branding has changed, but only slightly. So listen, right, okay, let's get into the weeds, because we got loads of good questions, loads of great comments. I want to address this one first. This is a very good one from Timothy Appling. Start with a bend up and use vibrato while coming down, and it sounds like a baby crying. That's interesting, which is in contravention to what I said earlier on, but I guess that probably could sound really cool like this. That's actually really haunting and really interesting. Sounds like a ghost. If you re-pick it, it sounds very cool. Sneeze. Twice. I have a strange genetic disorder. It's not really a genetic disorder, but I have a strange thing where I can't sneeze. I can't sneeze once, I have to sneeze twice. If I sneeze once, I know another is coming. Marcin's got a very cool addendum to the 10 note lesson, which is record yourself and rate it once again after listening. You know what? That's really interesting. I would maybe do both, right? I'd rate in the moment, and then I would also assess after the fact and see how much your ratings jive with each other. See if you're actually good at detecting this stuff as your thing's going on. That is fascinating. Very cool. Very, very cool. Now, Steve Ford had a cool question. I think because I'm a moron, I forgot to star it up, but that's okay. Let's just go find it. Now, where are you? Ah, here we go. What about bending the string down as well, says Steve Ford. Now, I'm guessing you're referring to one of two things here. It can be either bending the string down in pitch, or it can be bending the string with a downward motion. Now, until now, we've done all of our bends with a push. The G string, we can do either. We can either do pull down, or we can push up. As a rule, B string and E string, you should always push up, and then D string. And low E string, we should pull towards the floor. So mechanically, that's kind of, I guess you might think about it as the bottom three strings we always pull, the G string we can pull, but we can also push, and the highest two strings we always push, just because we want to leave ourselves clearance to be able to bend as far as we want to and then put some vibrato in the end. If you bend downwards on the B string, you're playing a very dangerous game where you might run off the end of the fretboard. And even if you don't, I always think it sounds kind of tentative. As if, like, you're kind of afraid to get to where you're going. So I think push is the way there. Now, as far as bending down in pitch, very interesting question, right? Very, very interesting question. As far as bending down in pitch goes, what we can do here is we can use things like pre-bends to simulate the sound of bending down. Obviously, we can't loosen a string by bending on it. Whichever direction we go in, it's going to go higher in pitch, because what we're doing is stretching the string or tightening it, a little like tightening a tuning peg. But we can pre-bend and release that bend. And that can be as big as we want. We can go, now pre-bends are fascinating because it's an example. We can't know what pitch we're at the pre-bend. We cannot know until we hit it. It is Schrodinger's bend. It is both in tune and out of tune until we play it. But here's a really fascinating thing. If we do our pre-bends right, we have the ability to micro-intonate. And watch anybody who's good at doing pre-bends, you'll even see this happening with just microscopic movements of the hand. You know what you're looking for, you can see it, where we can micro-intonate with pressure from our fingers. Like there, I was sharp. But I was able to release a little bit of pressure with the fingers to bring it into tune without having to do the broad brush strokes of wrist movements. So you might think about it as like the wrist or the forearm gets you in the ballpark, and then a little bit of finger movement gets you very finely intonated. If you ever tuned Floyd Rose, think about it like that. Tuning here is the wrist, and then the fine tuner is down here in the bridge. That's your fingers. It's another way of thinking about it. But I like to take the cues from violinists on that. You know, they get in the ballpark with the finger, position, and then finely rotate the finger to intonate it. It's fascinating, right? And we can do the same. So your pre-bends are a really good way of doing that. And it creates the same effect as bending down. Of course, if you had a bar, we could do that. Cow Cat, great question. Speed of vibrato tailored to a particular subdivision or not? Sometimes yes, sometimes no. Michael Schenker, a lot of people mentioned Michael Schenker in the stream so far, had this fantastic ability to either do his vibrato in like eighth triplets or sixteenths, depending upon what the song was going in. It always grooved. And there are times when that sounds absolutely bang on. There are other times when it sounds a bit contrived. You'll sometimes see this where people put on the wide rock vibrato, but it doesn't really seem authentic because it's a bit too pretty. It's a bit too like, okay, that's very controlled. You're playing very in time and very in tune, and it's very smooth, and it doesn't really sound very rock, even though it sounds very wide. It's like Rock by Numbers. You know what I'm talking about. It's not really the thing. Now, admittedly, I'm deliberately playing a bit you know, less than inspired there. There are times when playing vibrato in tune is, in time rather, is fabulous. Also, times when it's fine just to be completely, I guess atemporal, I out of time. I guess it's contextual, but there's definitely times when it's cool. There are times when it's not cool. I guess it depends upon how on you want it to sound. If you want it to sound very, very, like, sure of itself and very together and very composed, then yeah, great, play it in time. But if not, hey, maybe don't. Steve Vai's vibrato, isn't that a little bit theatre? It's an interesting observation. I'm not sure I'd say theatre, but it's a very, very interesting vibrato that Steve has. He has a series of vibrato that he'll do. He'll do classical vibrato sometimes, like this. Bar, but we also have this very interesting circular. Which I always butcher. It's very hard to do there. I can do it with the G string. Hard to do. And sometimes it even sounds, dare I say, right? Steve Vai is the master, he's the man. But even sometimes it sounds like he sometimes gets a little jagged, and that can sound really interesting. For me, if I want that sound of going either side, I'll do classical vibrato, because I generally don't have a bar handy. So I'll do. Saying that, it's quite easy to do it in the low strings. Ooh, hot. That's tough to do. I can't get that right today. I need to be on the money with that. That makes sense. So there you go. Another couple of great questions. Let's see now. What do we have? We have some new ones coming in. Slash is pretty good. Yeah, for sure. Right, okay. Now, I recently did some... Oh, there we go. Circular vibrato, as if by magic. Here's an interesting thing. What string gauges are you using, Nick? These are 10s. I think it's time for 11s, but these are 10s. Whittle Monks are 6s by the look of it. Now, these are 10 to 46. Pretty standard. I always play 10. This is a fun fact, right? I bop around between string gauges. I've got a drawer full of them here. Sometimes I'll do... 9s, we'll do them sometimes. I like paradigms, they're cool. I like normal gauges because you can get the fancy strings. Then there's 10s, that's what we got on right now. I've got some 10 and a halves kicking around. What's the heaviest stuff we've got kicking around here that I don't use for specialty stuff? Let's see, I've got a couple of packs of 11s, a couple of packs of hybrid 11s that are quite good fun. Some enormous strings that I'll use for baritone tunings. I tend to bop around a little bit, but I always play 10 to 46 in the run-up to the NAMM show. And NAMM's in a couple of weeks. When the run-up to the NAMM show, I'll always play 10 to 46 for a couple of months because every guitar at the show will have 10 to 46 on them. So I better be used to playing 10 to 46. That's it. It's pretty much the reason. I think I need 11s for where my hands are at right now, but 10 to 46 is what we're doing. So anyway, because, you know... training a lot in the minute, doing a lot of grip work, grip's getting pretty strong. Anyway, listen to Slash, right? Slash was a very, very good one. We'll talk about David Gilmour's bends in a moment. Slash is pretty good. Now, I did some sound likes for Victory recently, and Slash was the hardest one to get right, like, no doubt. And what it came down to was Slash is absolutely battering the strings, right? So if we try and play, like, something, I guess, something Slash-esque, maybe. If we maybe try some, like... try here. Mm-hmm. neck pickup and start to absolutely brutally bash the string. In a way that I find very hard to play cleanly, that we start to get the slash tone. Very hard to do, but it's the interaction again between bends and pick attack. I'll talk more about that another time, I think, because that's an interesting topic. But yeah, for sure, David Gilmour's string bends. Now, one thing that we can talk about at length with Gilmour is it's a phenomenal guitar player. Very, very good at the old string bends, as you guys have rightly pointed out. But what some people talk about quite a lot is this business of compound bends, which are really fascinating and something that I always attribute to being a Gilmour type sound, although I hear Lukather do them quite a lot as well. The compound bend would be where we bend to a pitch and then we bend again. So you might get something like this, this good old fashioned. Very cool. Now that kind of like up and down, further up and down thing is very Gilmour, but what we can also do is we can bend to a certain pitch, park it, and then go further. So good places to do this are places where you can afford to go a tone and then a semitone. That'll work pretty well. So for example, here in A minor, you can bend a tone, and then another semitone on top of it. And then release them all. That's very far. See what I mean about needing 11s? That was kind of painful. See where I dropped a weight on my finger. That's another story. So yeah, that's a very, very cool thing that Gilmour does. The compound bends thing is absolutely fascinating. I feel like that's a whole stream all into itself. So guys, listen, we've run clean out of time. We had a load of questions. I didn't get through them all. I will try my best to get through as many of these next week as we can. But in the meantime, I'm going to leave you with those thoughts. So make sure, grab your guitars, keep your guitars handy. If you haven't done it already, do that 10-note lesson. Right, that 10-note lesson, figure out how good you are at doing your bends and vibrato. But also, don't forget, like, you should be monitoring this over time. Right, you should be doing this fairly regularly and seeing if you can improve on the things that you like and get better at not doing the things you don't like. But that starts with establishing what those things are. So, you know, you need to know what you like and what you don't like before you can do more that you like and less that you don't like. So, good place to begin. Very interested to know what your scores are. So, once you're done with this, come back to this video, which will be available on YouTube. So, go to the Guitar Interactive YouTube channel. You'll find this video. Drop us a comment. Let us know what your score on the 10-note lesson was. In the meantime, I'm going to play a little bit more on this Fleetwood Mac backing track because it's lovely. My name's Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive GI+. See you guys next week. Such a lovely intro. Just volume pedal, right? That's what the volume pedal's for. So anyway, listen, we'll play a bit more. I'll see you guys next week. phrase and a good note to finish on. My name's Nick Jennison. See you guys next week. In case you haven't done so already, be sure to check out GI Plus because you get all this stuff in your membership. My name's Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Or maybe country's more your bag. Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from fusion maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters. Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Tolson Abassi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today.